welcome to the HPPO Show, Episode 3. Last week we left off, we finished 4 combat cards. This week we're going to finish 4 non-combat cards. I'm going to talk for a few minutes about how and why you should steal stuff. Again, about creativity. Okay. So if you're watching this on the VOD, on this stream we do game development. We are developing a 4-player card game, currently titled Freelander Adventures. It will be a 4-player cooperative card game where each turn players go on quests, collect gear, all to power up for epic monster combat, 3 rounds of increasingly difficult epic monster combat, and the player team is successful and wins the game. I hope for a game session to last about 60 minutes or less. As far as game style and difficulty, I want this game to be more complex than Munchkins, but way less complex than D&D. So, yeah, I think that about sums it up. All right, so today's talk. is about how and why to steal shit. So if you've ever heard any of these phrases before, there's nothing new under the sun, is from Ecclesiastes. Everything is a remix by some DJ. You don't have to do something new, you just have to do it better. Sam Walton said this. So these are all quotes about why you should be stealing stuff, because there are no new original ideas. Look, I know you think you have an original idea, and an original idea is what you want as a person, but it's not what other people want. It's been proven over and over and over again. Like, originality doesn't always mean good. New, in fact, more often than not, means risk. And risk is bad. I mean, it's a great board game, but it's a terrible gamble. If you're gonna spend time and money on something new, right, there's a higher chance of failure than if you just make better something somebody already likes, right? If original ideas paid off, then we wouldn't be living in the era of live-action Disney remakes, right? Which are still making a lot of money, and they're safe bets. So now that you know that you should steal ideas, settings, characters, concepts, right? Let's talk about how to steal. First thing I would do is look at the public domain for ideas. Should always be your first place to look to steal shit, because it's not illegal to steal anything from the public domain. Everything in the public domain is yours to steal for free. Right, whether it's Shakespeare or an obscure novel or Mark Twain, all these things you can reprint, resell, and then you don't have to worry about fair use, because you can just point to it and be like, oh no, I took this from Edgar Allan Poe, I didn't take this from you, just because you believe what you have used the material for is fair use just means that you have to prove in court that is the case. You'll have to prove to people that you have a fair use defense, and that'll be messy. You'll have to hire lawyers. It'll be expensive. And really, as a last resort, you should only be using things that are still covered by copyright. And if you are using things that are covered by copyright, make sure you're inspired by them and you're not directly word for word, beat for beat copying them. Like, it's okay to make a magical school of wizards and witches, but you can't call that school Hogwarts. That ship sailed, right? But as soon as you make a magical school, people are going to say, oh, and compare it to Hogwarts. That's just the way it is. Inspired, what I mean by inspired is that people should see what you're trying to do, right? So people should automatically see that you're trying to make a magical school like Hogwarts. But here's the big but, the big old juicy but. It doesn't mean you can just copy it. You may have to mix together 4 or 5 sources of inspiration and mix them so well that you have something new, right? For the example of this, take the billion-dollar movie Joker, right? To most audiences, this is a new and original story about the Joker, right? This isn't Heath Ledger's Joker. This isn't Jared Leto's Joker, right? This isn't the Mark Hamill voiced Joker from the animated cartoon. But this Joker isn't completely original either, right? It pulls from the Joker's own canon, the Killing Joke, where the Joker has multiple backstories, and essentially the Joker believes everyone is just one bad day away from becoming a villain. The movie pulls half of its beats from the Robert De Niro film Taxi Driver and the other Robert De Niro film The King of Comedy, right? Both late 80s movies that made Robert De Niro's early career. Now, you know Robert De Niro, the late night talk show host on the movie The Joker? Yes, this is clearly a nod to his roles in those two movies. They were very meta, very self-aware, but audiences now are so young and those movies haven't been seen for decades popularly, so you have to be of a certain age, typically over 40, to even be aware that those movies existed. Right, that's one of the reasons why this movie pleased a bunch of online critics who can actually put people's butts in seats. And no, I'm not talking about the drama with SJW critics and things like that, who said, don't go see this movie, it's terrible, it's alt-right or whatever. Like, we see time and time again, their reviews and their Rotten Tomatoes opinions don't matter, because there are plenty of films that get 100% Rotten Tomatoes certified fresh but have low audience scores and people don't go and see those movies. So again, this movie isn't original, right? You're taking a known property, the Joker, in a hot category right now that everyone's aware of, superhero films, right? You're sourcing the script from the cult and critically acclaimed classics, The King of Comedy, Taxi Driver, The Killing Joke. You're taking a known star actor who's fantastic in most of his roles. He's the reason why I thought this movie was going to be good, because Joaquin Phoenix always knocks it out of the park. Right? And you even have Robert De Niro as the other main actor in the film. And unlike certain actors who just take roles for paychecks, I think of Nicolas Cage, Will Smith, like who do put butts in seats, but they haven't always been associated with the best films. Yeah, if Robert De Niro's in it, it's probably going to be worth watching. Now, you won't have access to things that are under copyright like they do, right? They could have clearly worked with the studios, already had it under things like The King of Comedy, Taxi Driver. They clearly had permission from DC. Like, you're going to have to work around copyright. Now, if you're going to be inspired by the Joker, right? Who else was inspired by the Joker? For one thing, I can think of the Insane Clown Posse. Stephen King's It, right? Pennywise the Clown. It worked for Rob Zombie and the Devil's Rejects. Right, so you can take the aspects of the Joker, the white face paint, the clown aesthetic, the you really shouldn't take the color scheme, but everyone should see like a direct one-to-one comparison, right? Yours instantly conjures that image of like, oh, this is like Batman's Joker. This guy's crazy. And somewhat of a clown. Okay, and now let's get on to today's work and steal some shit. So again, last time, what we did is we looked at the top 100 downloaded ebooks on Project Gutenberg, gutenberg.org, and these are the top 100 public domain downloaded ebooks. And what we did is find sources for what our combat cards should be, right? So that instantly the four combat cards we created right, the four combat cards we created, Frankenstein, right, the Raven, playing card soldiers, right, from Alice in Wonderland, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, right, you defeat these four monsters, and then we're also doing a special loot system where you'll get a special power-up for defeating these monsters, and the power-up will change what it does for you based on whether you're an intelligence character, a wisdom character, a strength character, constitution, dexterity, and charisma. Since right now there are pretty much only three types of characters, right? If you're a mage or a cleric, you're probably going to be high in intelligence and wisdom. If you're a barbarian or a fighter, probably going to be high in strength and constitution. And if you're a rogue or an assassin or a bard, you're probably going to be high in dexterity and charisma. Right, so look at the last thing we created was Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde. Right, the challenge that you have to beat is roll a d10. If the number is greater than 5, fight Mr. Hyde. Otherwise, fight Dr. Jekyll head to head in a combat roll. Right, because it'll be harder to kill Mr. Hyde than it will be to kill Dr. Jekyll. So if you fight Mr. Hyde, you need to win 3 combat dice tosses. If you lose, you take 4 damage. That's very similar to the Frankenstein card. So that'll be our tough monsters. We'll have that 4 damage. And then in order to defeat Dr. Jekyll, you have to win 2 combat dice tosses. If you lose, you take 1d3 of damage, right? So you could take anywhere between 1 damage and 3 damage, which is way less than you would automatically take from taking damage from Mr. Hyde, right? Optional challenge, if you're facing Dr. Jekyll, you can do an intelligence check, Q Cure the Man and double your loot, right? Or if you're facing Mr. Hyde, you can do a charisma check, sing the man a lullaby, probably stab him in his sleep. So the standard reward would be 2 loot. So if you cure Dr. Jekyll, you'll get 4 loot, right? The special reward you'll automatically get for defeating Dr. Jekyll or Mr. Hyde will be called right now Berserker's Blood. If the player's highest stat is intelligence or wisdom, for one action you may tap this. This does not untap ever. While this is tapped, your intelligence and your strength are switched. Right, so you can trade all your intelligence for strength. Instantly go from, like, so this may be very good for a cleric whose wisdom is high, right, and intelligence is semi-high, so that they can trade their intelligence, their second highest stat, for their wisdom, or completely just change their character's dynamic, so now the rest of their special rewards give them the strength bonus and not the intelligence bonus. Right, and again, I made a note here. I will have to specify that it only checks player stats once at the time of tapping. Now, if you're a strength character, once per turn, you may tap this Berserker's Blood, take a D3 of damage, and add a D6 to your strength. Right? If the player's highest stat is Dexterity Charisma, you are the owner of many leather-bound books that smell of mahogany. A very dated joke, but I like it, so it's going to stay. For one action, you may tap this for +3 Charisma. Because as brutal as Mr. Hyde was, if you know the story, Mr. Hyde was the charismatic of the two, right? Dr. Jekyll would stay in his lab all the time, shy around people, whereas Mr. Hyde would go out and get some, you know, talk to the ladies at the bar, beat up their boyfriends. Looks like we got a beta Jekyll and an alpha Hyde. So, okay, I don't want to go over those too much. So let's get back to today's work. Our non-combat cards. So, as far as the non-combat cards go, the last thing we did was Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Let me look on here for a minute. Like, drawing a quest card that's a non-combat from the pile will probably not carry the threat of death like the combat encounters, but it should, like, I think it would be best if there was definitely a lot more agency in the non-combat cards. So you get to choose, like, what roles you're going to do to try to complete the quest. And perhaps that determines your reward. Right, so first let's find something good. So number 28 is what we had last time. Unless, of course, So next on the list is Scarlet Letter, right? Okay, yeah, I could turn that into a non-combat card. Well, she wasn't really a widow. I'll just call her Scarlet. So the book, The Scarlet Letter, is of course about how a woman is branded with the scarlet letter of an A for adultery, because she refuses to tell the town what man got her pregnant, which wasn't her husband, because her husband hasn't been there for 2 years, so it clearly wasn't him. It turns out it was the preacher's assistant, who is now the preacher of the town, and so she has to keep that secret and bear the shame and all that good jazz. If you probably are still required to read it in high school, but you probably don't. So yeah, we'll go with that. Design note, Scarlet Letter. So that'll be the basis for this quest. So I think these non-combat quests will probably sign up top image, and then text. Like, I want to know how to say this properly. Because at the top of the card, we want to have an image so people understand, and then we'll probably want to have flavor text or status text. Status text, and then we'll give the player one of three options. Give player one choice of so I think definitely after I after we design the bones of this card, I'm gonna go into Krita, and then I'm going to plot out exactly how this one's going to look, because I think on the combat cards we're definitely going to have more image, more space on the card for the monster, because it's way more straightforward. And then unfortunately this means that, like, the art to text ratio on the cards will be variable, but I'm okay with that. So that's fine. I don't know. So we're gonna give the player a choice of three options, and those options are the challenges. So three options / challenges. Challenge one. Go ahead and copy that. So I have that later. Okay, go ahead and copy that. The preacher in scarlet, design note, scarlet letter, top image. Okay, so the top image, clothes hanging on a tree in the woods and musical moans from off panel. Status text. During a walk in. During a walk in the woods, you find that the preacher and the married Miss Scarlet are engaged in summoning devils. What do you do? Okay, so here are your options. Rush in to stop their wicked ways. Try to join them. They were doing it wrong anyways. Or the third one. So again, I don't really like necessarily want to make this, this is what you should do if you're an intelligent, wise character. This is what you should do if you're a barbarian. This is what you should do if you're one or the other. These should be more of a role-playing-esque type thing. So far you have your two options, right? You have the what I think is basically the paladin, right? Rush in and stop them from summoning demons, aka getting down and dirty, doing the deed. Or do you try to join them? Yeah, definitely a thing for the bards. Oh, well, yeah, I just thought about what the rogue would probably do, steal their shit. So, okay. Or do you take their laundry while they are busy, clean it for them, and charge them a small fee for your services? Yeah. Yeah, okay, I think that might work. Because, again, I don't really want, like, the character starting stats will be so similar that while some quests like this will be possible to choose all the challenges, some quests like will only be able to choose, like, well, you'll have a higher success rate of choosing another. Add your strength. Pass if roll is higher. So, again, if you're not charismatic, but you're probably going to have a charisma higher than 4, so you just need to roll the 10, right? Or an 8, if, say, your charisma's 6 because you're a fighter with low charisma. You roll a d10, right? So if you roll 8 or higher, you're going to pass the challenge to join them. Right, if you're a weak character but you want them to stop worshiping summoning demons, aka the dirty deed, the night bumps, the baby making, right? So I think both those are good. And then yeah, I think this would probably be the lowest check. So if your number is higher than a 9, right? So the easiest thing to do would be to steal their stuff and get out. Now, I like the special monster. Okay, I think I have the solution. For non-combat cards, we're probably just going to add. We're going to add to your character stats, right? So we'll see how that works, and if that's broken in playtesting, then we'll go back to the drawing board and we'll come up with something else. So if you rush in and stop them, if you're successful, one bonus to your constitution. I want to make this number 0.05. And for the super easy one, the reward will be 2 loot. Yeah, let's make the reward 1 loot and draw. Face down. Make sure that's what. Face down gear pile. Okay, so if you do the easy one, you'll get 1 loot and draw from the face down gear pile, which is widely different than if you try for these ones. If fail, you get nothing. Right, so on the third challenge, there's a very, very small chance you'll fail, because even if you're dexterity is only a 6, right? Or your dexterity is, that should be 9. If your dexterity is a 6 or a 7, right? Then you could fail with a 1 or a 2 roll, right? Which sucks. More likely that you'll try one of these and you'll fail that. Like, I think these bonuses will end up being the better thing to go for early, and then these will probably be the better thing to go for later, because more gear and more loot later would be better, whereas these will help you in future rolls. Alright, so there we have the rewards and the special rewards. So then there we go. The rewards are based on the action you choose. Okay, now I'm going to pop over into Krita, and we're going to see how this looks, how this might look on a card. New. Now remember, a card is 2.5 inches wide by 3.5 inches tall. Right, that's a standard playing card. I still have all that animation stuff up. Now, as far as font, make sure that our font is 14. So let me put a box down here. That's frustrating. Crit had died. Relaunch it. Fun stuff. Well, that's very illegible. 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 Okay, so we're almost there. Actually, what might work let's try this. Let's open up a new one and make it 3.5 wide by 2.5 tall. Yeah, well, that's awkward. 2 inches. Okay, there we go. So there, we have the same card, except it's this way now. Okay. Even using like 75% of the card, right? We don't have enough space. Hold on, I gotta cough for a second. Okay, so this is a great thing with testing is now that we can actually visualize, like we have 75% of the card to use, even turn sideways, there's not enough space to put the three challenges on there. And the more complicated we make this game, right, the less intuitive it'll be for new players, which means more experienced players will have to do a little hand holding now and then, which is exactly what we don't want 100%, because you should just be able to pick up the rule book and intuitively understand this game. So, this is an absolute failure, but it's good because now we know, like, we can't do a non-combat card like this. So our other options now are to do non-combat cards with just one check or two checks. So if we do it with just two checks, we just lose the dexterity check of stealing all their stuff. Which should be fine since, like, rogues and thieves and assassins, probably. No, just rogues will be able to steal loot, as a victory condition anyways. And yeah, so yeah, okay. So we know now, going forward, you can only do two checks, because we're not going to have space for the third. Yeah, all right. So I'll save this one. Non-combat quest layout. Okay. And now let's get back to doing the other part. Okay. So you either get a strength check or a charisma check, right? And then you get a bonus to constitution or a bonus to, just make it a bonus to dexterity. Yeah, because if you join them, you're gonna get more flexible, right? I mean, someone's getting stretched out. Har har, har har, har har. Hey, it made me laugh. I think that's funny. Okay. Card number two. Right. The Adventures of Tom Sawyer by Mark Twain. Yeah, why not? That should be pretty easy. What do we have in that book? The most famous thing from that book is probably the whitewashing scene where Tom convinces people to whitewash his fence for him because he's lazy and he tells him it's fun. And maybe it is. Maybe it is. The town's boys come to you and tell you that old Tom hired them to paint his fence, and now he won't pay them. What do you do? Force old Tom to pay. Pay them yourself. Discard one loot or gear card. Add your strength or charisma. Passive higher than 14. Reward. One loot. Okay, so I think that works. Now, because in either case, you have the choice. Like, I think our starting stats will be 10, right? So even if you are the most charismatic class or the strongest class, right? You could still fail this if you roll a 3 or less. So it's unlikely that you'll fail, but if you fail, then nothing happens. If fail, nothing happens. Except everyone laughs at you. Okay, so that one's done and good. Now our next one. Card number 3. No, this is going a lot faster now that we know. Okay, we can have 2 and we can have the status text. Right. These cards will be visually distinct from the other choice of cards. So that'd be cool. Card number 3. What do we got next on the list? Ancient Legends, Mystic Charms, Superstitions, Jane Eyre, Grimm's Fairy Tales. So, like, we could source a whole bunch of things from the Grimm's Fairy Tales, right? How the Other Half Lives, Dubliner's Anthem by Ayn Rand, Great Expectations by Charles Dickens, Ulysses, Christmas Carol. That's strange. Index of Project Gutenberg works of H.G. Wells by H.G. Wells. Uncle Tom's Cabin, War and Peace, The Jungle. Huh, what is The Jungle? I don't know. I'm going to look it up. The Jungle by Upton Sinclair, summary. Oh, yeah, that's right. The Jungle is about working conditions of immigrants in the United States. Yeah, sure, we can have a Lenin-like card. The butchers won't cut meat, the bakers won't slice their bread, the barons want you to do something about it. What do you do? Two options. Okay, let's make this wisdom check. And a charisma check. Have they all been charisma checks so far? Yeah. Okay, let's try to make it a constitution check. Okay, do the work yourself until the barons, bakers, and butchers sort this out. award. Now we'll make it 17. I'll make it 18. Payroll. Draw 4 loot cards. So yeah, this will be a somewhat difficult test, right? Brokered deal between the parties. And your reward should be some charisma. Yeah. Where'd I put that up? Should be a healthy amount of charisma. 2 charisma. Okay, I'm gonna make a note to myself right here. All non-combat bonus rewards are permanent stat increases. Okay. Yeah. All right. Alright, let's do the next one. And then I'll take a break again. So our next one, what do we got? Gutenberg. The Republic by Plato, The Count of Monte Cristo. The Hound of Baskervilles. War of the World, Treasure, Little Green Goblin. Gulliver's Travels, Songs of Innocence, Autobiography of Benjamin Franklin by Benjamin Franklin. Devil's Dictionary. Well, that seems interesting. I'm gonna have to read that. The Wonderful Wizard of Oz. I don't know. Any suggestions, chat? Okay. All right then. Why do I do that? Okay, so I'm not getting any ideas from the Project Gutenberg. Let's see, we have 2 strength, 2 charisma. Oh, that's right, we deleted our dexterity one. We have one that requires no rolls. So we don't have any that require intelligence yet. So let's do something that requires intelligence. Darn it. Let's work completely backwards. Let's say you stumble across a bear trap. Challenge. Dismantle the trap, freeing the man. Foot. Okay. I think that's pretty good. A man caught in a bear trap. Give the player 2 options. Dismantle the trap, freeing the man. So if you're smart enough, you can take it apart and free the person. Reward. Okay, I think that's good. Plus 5 bonus to intelligence and 1 loot. Plus 5 bonus to dexterity and 1 loot. If fail, take 2 damage. That one will have consequences, but again, that's non-combat, right? You came across a man stuck in a steel bell trap. It's a man in a bear trap, duh. Okay. Boom. 4 cards done. I think it's time for another cigarette. Okay, thank you for joining us on today's episode of Freelancer Adventures. Or whatever I'm calling this. Oh, that's right. I'm calling it the HPPO Show. Go ahead and leave a like, leave a comment. If you're watching this VOD on Twitch, I have a suggestion box down in the doobly-doo. Leave a comment of things you'd like to see, things that are cool. Any ideas you have to improve this game. Share this among your group. Come hang out. We stream live every Friday, 3 p.m. Eastern to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, where we create live on stream our own card game, which will be in Kickstarter probably around June of 2020. So the purpose of this stream is to create all the backbones of this card game, raise public awareness of it, beyond this. So if you share this, if you show up, right, if you start following this channel very irregularly, I'll just stream chill music and be doing concept art in my very, very poor attempts at drawing stuff. But today's episode was pretty good, right? We learned what we can and can't do with the physical space on the card, right? There is a strong motto in game development that you should fail and fail faster, right? In our very first card, the Preacher and the Scarlet, we failed very quickly because we wanted to make this somewhat like the monster cards, where you would have three different types of rewards or paths you could choose from, but there's just not enough space on the card for that. So instead, right, because the monster cards will have their own separate card for the rewards, so they'll have plenty of space to reward each character class a bonus to that character class, but we only have so much space on the non-combat cards. So even with the non-combat cards turned sideways, there's just not enough space for three options. So we have to go with two options. On our first card, the Preacher and Scarlet, based on the Scarlet Letter, we find clothes hanging on a tree in the woods and musical moans from off-panel as the image. During a walk in the woods, you find the Preacher and the married Miss Scarlet are engaged in summoning devils. I think that's pretty clear code words for the deed. And then, of course, all non-combat cards will ask, what do you do? Give the players a choice. Rush in and stop their wicked ways. Roll a d10, add your strength. Pass if you roll higher than a 14. So that'll be a pretty simple check, right? you probably only fail if you roll a 1 or a 2, even if you're one of the weaker classes. Try to join them. We should make this, this should be a stronger check, right? With a better bonus. So, if you try to join them, right, seduce them bard style, then you roll a d10, add your charisma, pass if your number's higher than 18. Doing the bard thing, plus 2 bonus to dexterity. So, the reward will be higher, but the check will be higher, because even if you're, say, a cleric class, and you have a... you probably won't be able to do it unless you already have gear or loot that adds bonuses to your charisma. So, but if you do, right, then you might be able to pass. But even if your charisma is 8, you'll need to roll a d10, so you'll have a 1 in 10 chance of actually passing this attempt, right? There's no penalties for failures on this card. Some of the cards, there are penalties for failures. The last card we created, Steel Bear Trap, there's a penalty for failure. You'll take damage. You're trying to free a man from his own trap design. So, that's what we did on today's stream. If you enjoyed listening to the sound of my voice on my super shitty mic, or you want to... help this stream, the best thing you can do right now is share this among your communities, bring your friends to the stream live, follow my Twitch channel, subscribe to this YouTube, like, comment, engagement, you know, even dislikes help, right? Because that shows somebody cared about it, even if they cared in the negative. Yeah, all right. Looking forward to the next stream next Friday, February the 28th, 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Our stream for next week will be going over either gear and creating that, or we'll be going over loot, or we'll be going over feats. We still have to tackle the problem of epic monster combat. That's probably going to take a whole month of streams. So I definitely hope we have a lot more people in Twitch chat to help me out with that. Or watch me suffer in excruciating pain as I try to resolve one of the greatest challenges with this card game. Alright, thank you so much for your time. And enjoy the rest of your day. Much love. HPPO out.